transportation departments are the front line of equity, diversity, and inclusion in our theaters. They wanted a discussion about how we talk about class, race, and socioeconomics in our education programming. What kind of cultural competency do we need to cultivate? Other questions we considered were, how do we support our education department staff and teaching artists who are attempting to embody ED&I values not only within the organization, but within schools? How are teaching artists approaching topics of race, class, and socioeconomic challenges in the classroom, in post-show discussions, and in community engagement sessions? How do theaters for young audiences prepare their audiences to engage the topical issues that are so highly charged and ubiquitous nowadays without becoming overly political themselves? How can education departments encourage or lead their theaters toward examining all of these issues? And how do education departments bring these very important ED&I practices from the department to scale through their theaters? So, to lead us through this work, I am delighted to introduce Nicole Brewer, who is adjunct professor of theater arts at Howard University, who will lead us through her conscientious theater training. Please join me in welcoming Nicole.
So conscientious theater training is what we're going to talk about today. From the intro that Lori gave, you can maybe glean that this is, could be an uncomfortable conversation, yeah? So we want to start a little bit of session agreements here. Now, any workshop that I normally do, I always have session agreements. I stole this from a workshop that I was at and I thought it was brilliant, yeah? So I have been in so many unsafe spaces that it has become just a part of who I am, that I want to create that for other people. And as if this workshop and this young lady was like, safety subjective. And I was like, shit, you're right. How arrogant of me to think I can create a safe space for anyone, right? But she said, we can create spaces with shared expectation. And in that way, make the space brave for someone to participate. So we're all educators and adults, and we get it. So I'm just gonna truncate this list that I normally have of like 10 things to 3, maybe 4. So the first one is speak from the eye, right? So I'm gonna talk a little bit, but I don't pretend to know everything, right? I am one person walking in this skin and have my experience, okay? There are a lot of us here today.
Yay, educators.
Yeah, and so the collective knowledge in the room, I think, is astonishing, and we should be using each other to answer questions that I may not have the answer to, and I will not, even though I am an actor, stand up here and act as if I do, yeah? So know that that works two ways, yes? I don't have all the questions, but I'm gonna listen to what your question is. If you have something that you can add to what someone's saying, let's talk about it, okay? So, but speak from the eye. So I don't wanna hear about your, you know, co-worker's experience or something that happened in a class that you weren't at. I just want you to talk about things from your perspective, okay? So speak from the eye. Trust intent, but name impact. So we're gonna be talking about race. There's an exercise we're gonna get up and move around, get the blood flowing, both in the brain and in the body. And so things might come up that make folks feel uncomfortable. We don't have to swallow that, okay? You can name the impact of what someone has said to you, but trust that today, for this session, the intent was not to be malicious. The intent was not to hurt your soul. The intent was not to attack your identity, okay? That it comes from just a place of ignorance. And if we could just take away the negative connotation with the word ignorance and hold it up for what it is, which is lack of knowledge. Yeah, okay? So, trust, intent, name, impact. Don't assume identity. Woo! I'm working on this one every single day. We don't know, right? So you don't know, just ask. Don't assume, okay? I feel like there was one more. So let me look at my little notes here. But I felt, oh yes. Lean in, stay present, right? So when talking about race, I've created this imagery, so I also like to do photography. So if any of you are also photographers, like not on your phone, but you've got and I always say that not to be funny, but just to talk about apertures. So I say our emotional aperture, right? And I'm gonna speak from the eye. Look at me, I'm gonna follow session. The emotional aperture for myself, when I feel like I'm being attacked, it begins to close. Okay? So this idea of leaning in and staying present is about propping it open. Okay, with whatever you're gonna prop it open with, to just stay present in that uncomfortableness. I'm not saying that you'll find resolution and then you'll become comfortable, but I'm saying there is something to be gained from being uncomfortable, right? We live in a society that just values comfort all the time. But sometimes we just need to push through and be uncomfortable, okay? So lean in, stay present, speak from the eye, trust intent, name impact, identity. Is there anything on those four that you all feel like we need to add in order for you to feel brave enough to engage in the conversation we're getting ready to have? Like, what's the conversation? I don't know, right? But do you think you need to add anything? Yes. Oh, I don't know if they're in any particular order. Trust, impact, name, intent, don't assume identity, speak from the eye.
That's four.
All right, so we good? So can we all agree to that? And if you can, you can just nod your head and say yes. Either one is fine.
Yes.
Excellent. Shall we move on? I think we shall. Okay. Red, my friend. Is that Matt coming for us?
Absolutely.
I just took that liberty, my bad. Okay. All right, Red, let's look at this first one, right? So we're in this conference, we need a little bit of humor. Industry and the bias in the industry and what the industry is lacking, and industry this and industry that. And I think to myself as an educator, right, well, where did they get the knowledge to be implementing the ideas and practices that they implement? It's the education, right? So for me, instead of engaging in conversations about the industry, I went back, I took a couple of steps and I said, let's look at the education. What are we teaching people, well, consciously and unconsciously, that tends to find its way into the industry and present as white supremacy? Let's not mix words. Biased, right? Ableism, sexism. We can keep going on and on, right? So addressing that. So conscientious theater training came out of me just going, wait a minute. And also a very horrible experience I had in graduate school, which if you're interested in more of that, I wrote about it. It was published in American Theater in January. It's called Training with a Difference, but I will not waste your time with that right now. Okay, so I have a rhetorical question that I'd like to ask you before we go to the next slide. Don't go, look at me. And then we're gonna circle back to this question at the end of our time together. So what I'd like to plant in your mind right now is, how do you, and by you, I mean you, and your organization, right, that you represent or work for, How do you address oppressive policies, curriculum, and bias in your program or programming? Okay? And then here's this little bit that Karen was touching on too, accountability. How do you vet these initiatives, right? So this is accountability. How do you measure success? You know, bias, gone. Oppression, gone, right? How are you able to go like, yeah, that's what it is, okay? So we're gonna, we'll cycle back to that at the end, but I wanted to plant that seed right now. Okay, go ahead, give it next to that. All right, so just because we're all on different schedules and you might have to get up and go, I'm kind of documenting where these sources are slide by slide so that you know I am not blatantly stealing other people's work. So in the 80s, they had like 7 good principles for education as a general thing. And then in the 90s, it was revamped to include technology. Like 7 good principles for including technology. All makes sense. And so I came across this document in an online training class that I had to take. And thought, oh my God, some of these are quite good for conscientious theater training and principles, right? And so I won't bore you by reading. So they all say good practice, right? And so I'm going to say encourages contact between staff, administration, and participant and staff. What I mean by contact is both physical and listening. There was a study done where people went into a bank, okay? And the teller was the variable. Okay, so the person goes in, they have their exchange with the teller. The teller was told not to make any physical contact with the person at all. The person walks out of the bank, la-di-da. They're stopped, hey, can we just take a quick survey? How did you, you know, rank your service? They ranked it. The only change that was added to the teller was just find a way to touch the person in a way that, you know, let me just touch your hand, shake your hand, maybe let me touch your shoulder, right? So, in a way that wouldn't cause alarm and panic, okay? And then that patron went out and they were surveyed. And they found, not every time, but the majority of the time, that the people who were touched rated their service higher, right, than those who were not touched. So my asterisk to that is some of the communities that we're dealing with come from trauma associated with touch. So just as we go back to don't assume identity, you also don't want to assume that someone wants to be touched. And that may feel awkward that first time, but remembering to ask, may I give you a hug? May I touch you? May I touch your shoulder? Something like that helps to create a relationship. And when we're talking about racial issues, we need to be using everything in the toolbox to mend relationships because the relationships are broken, okay? Encourage contact. So I was on touch because sometimes people just talk about listening as a contact, but touch is also contact and it's important, right? So conscientious theater is asking people to develop reciprocity and then cooperation amongst the students. So this is another way of giving people agency. But if I respect you, you respect me, but I can't assume you know what respecting me looks like, yeah? So how do we have these conversations about talking about what that looks like within the classroom? Because it's gonna vary from age, culture, where you're from in the United States, so on and so forth. So being available to somebody else's vision of the world and not judging it, which is hard, right? I know it's hard for me, okay? Cooperation. People want to cooperate more when they know they have value in whatever it is that they are participating in. That they know that if I was missing, it would matter, okay? Not that I'm a number. Not that I'm checking off a box or something like that. So you can foster cooperation by letting people know that they matter in that space and in that time. And there's a myriad of ways you can go about doing it, and I'm sure many of you are already practicing these things, right? So, promoting agency and participants' learning experience. Some of your communities, this may be the first time these students have been asked to think about how they want their education to go, right? And so it can be scary. And they can be like, I don't know what you're talking about. Just tell me what the thing is, I'm gonna do the thing, and that's it, you know? And so you have to keep coming back to giving them that kind of agency over their life. And they're learning, okay? Excuse me, I meant learning, not their life. Good practice gives space for no thank you. This is something that I learned in grad school from an incredible friend of mine who taught me the power of no thank you. As an African-American woman born in the early 80s, my parents beat into me education, okay? And that you had to succeed. You had to get good grades, right? And in that, there's not much wiggle room for a no thank you. I'm exhausted. No thank you. It's not that I won't do this assignment, maybe I won't do it right now. I actually don't feel good. I'm a little sick, but before it blows into a big, huge thing, I think I'll just sit out on the side of the classroom. So ways in which you're saying no thank you, okay? So with conscientious ear practices, you have to be giving people that right to say no thank you. And no thank you without the excuses. Because when I do this in my classroom, students always come up to me and go, I came to class today because I wanted to prove to you that I'm really a good student, but I'm not going to go. So I'm just going to sit in the corner. Is that okay? Don't ask me. Is that what you need to do to be okay in class today? Yes. If you need not to be here and affect the rest of us, then go home, right? So you'll find that people will be mistrusting of this concept of no thank you, but it goes under this idea of self-care and it's important, okay? So you also want to make sure that you're emphasizing ways to bring people's cultural heritage and identity to the work. Using this to bridge the gap between identity and whatever it is that you're working on, right? But again, I want to be clear, crystal clear. I'm not talking about typecasting a person, right? So because you are this thing that you identify, that is the only way you may explore the world, okay? And I'm going to stop you if you're trying to do something different. No, that's not what I'm saying at all. What I am saying, it is right now, in many institutions, unique to tell someone it is okay to bring your differences into the room. And not just bring them into the room, embody them unapologetically with no, I'm sorry's. It's a unique situation, it's a novel situation, and it shouldn't be, right? In the theater, if we are really attempting to get at humanity in some way, right, now I'm talking lofty things, then why not bring the whole of who you are as a complex human being into the work and into these educational practices? I have many a times been asked to come teach hip hop theater. I don't know anything about hip hop theater. Why are you asking me to teach hip hop theater? Now, I didn't say I didn't love hip hop. I just don't know anything about it, right? And so we have to just be paying attention to how we're identifying people and what we assume their knowledge base is, okay? But then again, as I said before, because it's worth repeating, making it okay for people to bring whatever it is that they want to bring into the room without you pushing it, okay? Good practice, right? Listen, I've been a high school teacher. Right now, I currently teach on the collegiate level. And when I was a high school teacher in California, I worked at a high school that was specifically for students who've been kicked out of regular school, okay? And so this high school had a lot of brown babies, a lot of excellent brown babies, a lot of brown babies who had a lot of trauma, okay? But when I looked at these brown babies, I saw potential. When I looked at these brown babies, I saw the roughness of their environment, but did not conflate that with the intelligence in their head. Now, I cannot say that was true for the majority of the people that I worked with. And so therefore, my babies sniffed out these people who they considered to be weak, inferior, and stupid, and they ran all over them, okay? Now, not to pat myself on the back, but I went into the classroom with high expectations. And if they could not reach the expectations, let me figure out the path to get you there, because I'm not going to lower the bar. So if you can't read, that's fine. On my off time, I went to special education, I got packets for lower, you know, grades, and I brought them back to my students without telling them, okay? So I didn't make a big deal out of it, that a 16-year-old is reading at a fourth grade level. They don't need to know that. Can you do this work, right? That's what's important. And so time and time again, even in the theater world, I see this. I see, like, the educational outreach. You hire your teaching artists, they go out into these schools, they encounter something they're not familiar with, and they're just like, I don't know how to deal with these students, okay? Or something's up with these students. And it's not. Something's up with you, right? You need to be figuring out not just what they need, but how you even see these people, right? So have you come in as the savior with your artistic programming to save these people from their sad, sorry lives? And I mean, are you chuckling? But some of y'all write grants for this stuff.
Yeah.
You get that money, and you go into brown neighborhoods, and you do work that's actually damaging. So, you know, I got this platform. No, y'all might not invite me back. I got a step on my date, okay?
So, create these high expectations for your students, right? Create it in a culture of self-care.
Just like I cannot create safety for you, you don't necessarily know what self-care is for your community, but hey, you can find out. And I mean things that go beyond the no thank you. Things that go into, if we're gonna have a conversation that brings up trauma, how do you bring that person back to balance before you say adios, peace out, goodbye, right? So too many times I've seen that too. In the training, you have people wallowing on the floor, crying, spit everywhere, and then it's like, class is over. Wasn't that great? Wasn't that cathartic? No, it's not great, it's not cathartic. Many brown people in many marginalized communities, as soon as they walk out of that door, have to face a flood of trauma. And I'm not sure as theater people, we understand that with some of these things that we're teaching people. I just need you to be neutral, right? How can I be neutral when the moment I walk out the door, my color is what's seen? How can I be neutral when I'm always like, have I done the right thing to make the other person not come for me? So I think you have a duty of care to these communities that you are working with, to institute self-care practices so that when you ask someone to go to a vulnerable space, that you bring them back to balance. And that could be burning some Palo Santo. It could be burning sage. It could be hugs. It could be, it's something, but it has to be acknowledged. We need to restore ourselves to a place where we can go back out into the community, okay? And then lastly, talking about diverse talents and ways of learning that fosters collaboration and not compromise. So this isn't about me giving up something so you feel something. It's about you giving up something so we can work together. It's about collaboration. Some of your students are visual. So no matter how much you yak, talk, they want to draw about their experience. Some of them that are sitting there who are drumming and making noises or tapping, right? They're being percussive in some way, shape, or form. It's not our right to be like, hey, stop that. Focus, sit tight, pay attention, right? We don't live in that world anymore, okay? So how do you figure out a way to incorporate that type of way that they understand the world into your programming? Okay, so that you have other avenues for people to be able to express themselves. Yeah. Okay. And this one can be hard because we're still very much stuck in a colonial understanding of education. I thought I would throw that in there too. All right, so next slide. All right, so when we're talking about, flows of things, yeah? So if you're implementing conscientious practices, you always, and I know you know this, right? So please don't think that I'm talking down to you, but I am like going back to some basics and how we do it. You have to have the community at heart and not for what they can do for you, okay? So not this idea, hey, happy World Cup Day, by the way. My husband's a fanatic, he's already started texting me stuff. And I only bring that up because some of these teams have like schools that they send the little kids to, like they farm them up and then they get them into these professional teams, right? No judgment, okay. And so sometimes I think about that with certain institutions who I come into contact with, that their programs are about putting butts in seats eventually, okay? And so that's like, that's a monetary gain that you're looking to get, and this is just the way that you're doing it. And I'm not saying that's right or wrong. I'm simply asking you to think about the community and why you want to serve this community. How are you dedicating yourself to that service? Some of us come from communities that don't have any people, brown people, at all, right? This work is for you too, okay? It's not indicative to, oh my God, I have a minority, I have to do conscientious theater training. It is about wanting to educate everybody, about everybody, okay? So learning the values. When I say that, I mean of the community, not yours. You know what your mission is. What are their values? I'll give you an example. In the African American community, we tend to talk when we go to the theater, okay? It's just something that we do. This call and response thing happens, okay? We're not trying to be disrespectful. We're not trying to bring attention to ourselves. It's a part of the culture, okay? And so when we're talking about that value, well, how do we talk about call and response in going to see the theater? And that's hard to do when you're the only person talking back to the theater and you're like a sea of white people. They're around you and they're the only noise they make is rattling you with the candy. And you feel some kind of way. So you have to learn that, right? And say, here's how we're different. That's interesting that you want to experience theater that way and not shame somebody for wanting to participate in a way that they understand and they feel comfortable doing. Creating spaces, right? I think that Metro Theater did a very wonderful job. As soon as I walked in here, I saw lots of faces on the wall. That's important. So the type of space that you're creating for people that shows them reflected back or mirrored back to them, it's an unconscious way of saying, yes, you are welcome here, okay? And I think that's important, because I've been in a lot of theaters, and I know you all have too. And I'm from Washington, D.C. I'm not gonna throw anybody under the bus in Washington, D.C. But there are certain theaters that just have one black show, right? They got their black musical slot. They know that's gonna make some money, okay? And then you look at the wall, and you look at the posters, and what do you see? A sea of white stories, okay? So when I walk into that space, me as an adult, not me as a child or a young person who wasn't as aware, I go, this space isn't for me, okay? I'm not welcome here, except for that one slot in the season when you decide to do some show you've done 50 times because you're scared to do something else, okay? So that becomes important too. If you're saying that you reach out to diverse communities, I know you've heard this one before, stop putting these people on your brochures, but not in your hearts. That's not okay, okay? And that's my own little moment. So how do you create spaces, both unconsciously and consciously, that welcome the community that you wish to serve? Because I will tell you it is a myth, and I've heard it many times, that they don't want to act. Blacks don't want to act, Latinos don't want to act, Asians don't want to act. Are you crazy? Of course they want to act. I have people coming up to me all the time talking about wanting a career. But who wants to pay money for a place that's telling you everything about you is wrong? It's the way you sound, the way you look, right? So we got to think about that too. And we also have to stop this myth that these communities don't have money to spend on theater. Yeah. The most erroneous thing I've ever heard in my life. Okay? So feedback. You're gonna get feedback. You'll get feedback, and I'm not talking about this like, let's send you a survey kind of feedback. I'm talking about the feedback you get when you see a kid who didn't want to show up, or who's sitting in the corner, who starts showing up, right? What is that conversation that you have with them? Hey, maybe it's even just offering them a bit of encouragement. I like the work that you did today. You know, is your family coming to whatever it is, whatever it is? What's going on with them? So feedback becomes really important. Again, not this kind of let me give you a form, fill out the form, tell me what's on your heart, be honest, it's anonymous, right? Again, that's one particular way of gathering data. But it's proven that people of color come from communities where informal ways ways of gathering data can be very useful, right? Sharing a meal. Okay, just rather someone sitting down and rapping with them about their day, okay? These types of things can have more impact than a piece of paper in a survey about your teacher and the institution. And then adjust, right? There's no endpoint to this work, so you have to keep adjusting because your community is going to keep adjusting, right? Again, I said I live in Washington, D.C. 8 years that I've been in D.C., it has changed a lot. So one must adjust. And it will continue to change, I'm sure of that, with children mixing and so on and so forth, right? So keep adjusting what you're offering for the people who are in front of you, not the imaginary people you theorize. Okay? All right. So I don't know where my time is. Do I have a timekeeper, Lori? Are you keeping time for me?
Yeah.
How much time do I have?
Hold on.
45.
But we're over at 11:15. So you have 45 minutes.
45? Perfect. Okay. So Greg was very kind. And what Greg did was he hung up. We can turn the lights. We can turn the lights off. We're gonna pause this right here. He hung up these 8 questions. Now, I think these questions are brilliant, but they're not for me. So, right? I'm gonna source the on the next slide, I'll tell you where I got them from. But I want you to know I just adapted them for conscientious theater training. So I would ask that it'd be no more than 8 people at a question, okay? And I would love for you to just write your responses out to that. They don't have to be education folks. They don't have to be in full sentences. They can be a feeling in response to what you read, right? Like tightening. I read something and I felt myself tightening. I might write that on the paper, tightening. I might have an answer, right? So I might write an answer. I might just see stars and draw some stars on a piece of paper, right? Okay, so all I'm asking is that you put your imprint, your impression, or an answer to the question on the paper.
Would you like to read them out for people? Or
actually, you're gonna get up and go to them.
Yeah.
Oh, you mean, oh, for the howl around people.
Yeah.
I've written it down for you all, okay? I'm ready. All right, so these lovely people are getting up and they're getting ready to go do this activity. And so the questions that I have for them are, how do small and large theater institutions reproduce white coteries, exclusion, and racism? Okay, 2, what does the discourse of intersectionality enable and delimit in discussions around EDI or IDEA in theater institutions? How have critics and activists utilized the term intersectionality as a form of abstract theorizing and value signaling, including the specificities of race and racism in relation to class, ableism, sexism, transphobia, and homophobia, rather than serving to illuminate those specificities? Read it, yeah? How do ameliorative and tokenizing diversity practices often hold us up from rethinking traditional education standards and practices, right? Let's not get it twisted. Just because you put in a little EDI program doesn't mean the foundation of white supremacy has been disrupted. It's still there. It's completely intact, right? So we're talking about how we create auxiliary programs and pat ourselves on the back as if we've done something, and we continue to be complicit in the oppression of others. I love this brother up here laughing at me. All right, okay, all right. How do talkbacks continue to serve colonialist ideals, okay? We'll unpack that one later when you come back. What are the possibilities of decolonized and or anti-colonial theater programming? How might theater makers of color be centered in education programs rather than serving as the ethnographic checkbox decoration? Why are translation and multilingual plays or playwrights considered of a certain level of education, culture, and worldliness? And then some others serve as markers of difference, segregation, and exoticism, okay? What is educational programming's role in social justice and the movements against racism, imperialism, and white supremacy, if any? All right, hope I didn't scare you. Now you won't get out of your seats. Okay, so go ahead. There should be markers, and if not, I'll come around. Should be no more than 8 people at a question. I'm gonna add some papers to the ones for my questions tomorrow.
We wrote you one.
Just pick one.
Yeah. I think that's right, yeah. So, okay.
You just pick one.
Oh, you pick one?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
That's fine.
That's fine. Thank you. I know.
I'm so lucky.
It has the same base. What base? What is it spelled exactly?
I know it's not spelled exactly, but why do we... What is wrong with the English
Thank you.
our language in order to.
You will be asked to open the meeting about warning, warning. 4 minutes.
I
piece of paper with you. I would be very appreciative.
Thank you.
Ibsen? translations of such appear. But other plays, or other playwrights who want to write in their native language, who are being told, but the audience, they won't understand, okay? These kinds of things, yeah? So in that educational realm, this is what we're talking about, how your white, Eurocentric translations are okay. As a matter of fact, they're excellent. And up here, even if this is the unconscious, and anything else is relegated to auxiliary or other, and we pretend we can't say names, we can't get our tongue where it needs to be, and yet we all run around here talking about Stanislavski this and Stanislavski that, right? So some of the things that people said, old master frames versus young emerging artists, people with people with power reinforcing their own narratives, brilliant. Assumptions, love this question, assumptions, classism, elitism. And so I'm gonna go to this one. One is sad story that white English only speakers create to make them feel like they did this great service. Let me read the first one too, okay. One is an outlet of assimilation to make white English only speakers feel good, right? And so I won't get to everything on all of the papers because of time. I really want, at this point, wanted you, were your arms getting tired?
No.
Okay, I really want you to be able to hear other people's thoughts about these questions. Mr. Ali, you up here still in the show like a little baby or something. Okay, so, and so this is adding on to this, assuming English is the common text, that's so true, right? I mean, I think it's still true. The United States doesn't actually have an official language, right? Unless it's out of thievery. So, fear of maybe we are in the middle of change. We're absolutely not in the middle of change. We are far past that, right? But we have to understand that it cannot be business as usual. Languages, other, this person's handwriting is beautiful, by the way, so please don't associate my struggle with you in any way. Languages other than English are seen as sexy when used in particular spaces on stage, but not always a benefit. I don't know what this one says. Seen as maybe a benefit in other spaces, classrooms, materials, etc. Okay, great. So let's move on. Are any comments on this that you guys want to add? Is lunch next? Is that what I'm butting up against? No, you better be on time. Yes, ma'am.
Colonizer and colonization, but that had an economic bet. So the question then is to question the economy. And how do we shift? How do we enter? How do we grow? Because that's actually what letting people in does. It brings more money. And especially if you know how to do it right, it brings a windfall. Theaters that do it right do make more money. So I think the question is, you know, we have to question the economic structure and where language fits in, where the narratives, where the myths, because, you know, all the plays that we name are pulled from a particular myth that's rooted in a particular economy. Mm-hmm. You know, so I'd be interested in hearing more about that as well.
I would also suggest that if we define what theater is, then we'll have an interesting examination of this question.
Great, does anybody want to define what theater is? Challenge, I'm writing down, by the way, what you're saying. I'm adding it just in case it's not here.
I would say theater is it's a reflection of the human experience, right? And it could look in so many different ways, but I think that what we often miss is the interpretation of all those different ways that a story can be told. That's what I would say that is for me. I mean, I won't speak for anyone else, but I
sure
for myself.
I feel like we're dialoguing. I don't even want to give any unconscious level of superiority here, so I'm just gonna cop squat. Anybody else? What is theater? I mean, we are quick to define theater. It's in your mission statements, right? Your educational programming says this is what you were trying to accomplish, I hope, right? So you have defined it in some way for you, okay? I mean, I know what it is for me. It's not necessarily in a textbook, right? Go ahead, Mr. Allen.
Yes. After I'm studying the theater in college, after I'm working in the field, I realized there is no meaning of theater. I only concentrate on performance, more than the words theater. I try to translate it to my language, the Arabic language, because we talk about other writers.
Yeah.
So in the Arabic, we theater, the empty place, where you took the animals to eat. But when I start my performance, my theater, it's a commercial theater, it's a political comic theater. I have 1,300 audience every day for 8 years, the same people. You know, the Arab people, they came to the same because we talk about political issues in the country where there's no freedom. You know, I'm not talking about politics. Suddenly, I realized this is nonsense. People come in, pay a lot of money. When they go, they forget what I'm saying. So I start walking and looking at the difficulty of the people, at the conflicts in Africa. So I take my performance to the people. I'm not asking the people to come to the theater. I go to them in their places, in their villages, in the desert, in a very difficult situation. They're leaving, and I came in for 2 days. It's difficult for me, the 2 days. So how come they live all their life? So that's performance, not the theater, not the Italian box. This is how I understand, sorry.
Don't be sorry, no apologies, yeah.
Because all the theater came to us from abroad. I mean, the theater is like what I'm staying here, acting, and you are so happy, and you go after 2 hours, pay the ticket, maybe during the, you can go and have a drink and come back, whatever. In that place where we're doing our performance, no way. The performance can continue 1 hour, 4 hours, it depends on the audience themselves. So I always keep saying, my audience are partners. They are partners. Another explanation.
That's beautiful. That's why I said there's more heads in here than mine. I mean, I like it. So let's move on. We're good? Okay. So how have critics and activists utilized it yet? Yes. Yes for all of this. How have critics and activists utilized the term intersectionality as a form of abstract theorizing and value signaling? Hey, I'm down with it. Yeah. Including the specifics of race, racism in relation to class, ableism, sexism, transphobia, and homophobia, rather than serving to illuminate those specificities, right? And some of your responses to this, tokenizing minority voices, mushing together, and poverty, and ageism, absolutely. Catch-all, doesn't live specificity, right? This is more answers to this, let's go over here. Visible versus invisible, easy to see becomes the first. What is the role of the PR department? What are talking points? What is media training? Who is leading it and why? So guilty of it, and how do we actively change and prepare, right? Being visitors in a community and not becoming part of or advocating for the community, right? So how do we change and repair? Again, I'm not going to pretend that I have all the answers to that, but I have suggestions. It's doing the work, right? It's being uncomfortable. I mean, and I'm just sorry, like, You have to be uncomfortable. You have to be willing to pay for, let me underline that and look right into the camera when I say it, pay for people who have a specialty to come to your place and work with you. Hmm. Notice I didn't say teach you. I said work with you, okay? So people reach out to me, then I say how much I value my time for, and then I don't hear anything from them, okay? You want me, I guess, I'm assuming, I'm not talking about the people in this room, I'm speaking very generally, so please allow it. But it feels to me, when I speak from the eye, that because I'm black and I'm female, this experience that I had didn't require education, didn't require me studying, didn't require me to prepare for this. I just woke up this way and gave you this knowledge, right? But that's not true. I have lots of degrees and I own my student loans, okay? So reach out to these organizations and these people. Have them come collaborate with you, okay? If you cannot, if like you're out in the middle of nowhere and you don't have a budget for someone to come, then ask somebody if they would be willing to Skype or whatever other platform you want to use to talk to you. I mean, you still got to find some money to pay them. I'm not saying it's free, but I'm saying it's a solution. Now you don't have to pay for travel, okay? And you can have these like in-house training sessions, okay? So, how do we stop just talking about things? And this value signaling is really important. Do you have a question? Do you want to ask this?
No, just a riff. Just because what you're saying and looking back at the statement, the abstract theorizing of it versus what you're talking about, which is concrete, I would just add, have self-knowledge about your theater and your mission and who you are, and don't invite them unless you're really going to do something about it. You know, like feeling better about ourselves because we're enlightened doesn't change anything. And so you might be a small theater that's really focused on Shakespeare, whatever. Which of these, maybe it's all. But, you know, time is also money.
Yeah.
So prioritize and say, like, this is a community that I think we have to work with, or it's in our community, we need to bring them in. So I just wanted to add that because of the abstract theorizing part.
And it's beautifully noted. Yeah? The value signaling thing, and then I'll move on really quick. I've also had conversations with who are not of my particular race, that's not me assuming, they identify for themselves as they are, and they tell me all the time, when they identify themselves as white, as a white person, it's my time to step back and let others come in. As a white person, I know that these things are going on, but you have to understand that, well, my department is all white cis men, what can I do? I can only say so much, right? And in the beginning, I would just be quiet because these kind of conversations are, for me, you value signaling that you want me to give you a high five for that, right? But you're not listening. And the people who have these, I've had these comments, they're not listening, okay? We are human beings. We have put somebody on the fucking moon. I mean, like not to sound woo-woo, you know what I mean? Your obstacle of your department and this person who doesn't want to hear you for the umpteenth time, how do we get kids to eat food? I'm like, we keep giving it to them, right? And then, you know, you have to show the value. Sometimes you have to be willing to be uncomfortable. You got to be willing to get out there. That place that you're working at, this little fiefdom that you were like so dug into, may not be the place for you. That may not be the organization that you need to be tithing your time, your talent, or your artistry into. So if you look around, right, I'm gonna look to my left, I'm gonna look to my right, and none of these people are embodying the mission statement of the organization, and I've been trying my hardest, maybe it's time for me to step back, go out on trust or faith or whatever it is you believe, and find a place or create a space that will do the work that you wanna do, okay? And stop going up to people of color complaining about it. All right, did we do all these? Okay, good, let's move on. This one's a good one. Is that just one? Probably. Okay, we'll give you this one for the next one. Maybe that's that. Okay. Huh?
That's first.
Okay, this is first, yes. How do small and large theater often relevant on unpaid labor Grant language, I hadn't even thought about that. Wow, yes. Hiring white male teachers. Assuming a community's needs, here we go. Okay, so this is huge, right? Again, if this is an assumption that you're coming in to offer this underprivileged community a taste of the arts, because it changed your life, I think you should reevaluate that. I mean, seriously, that community has arts.
Yeah.
It's just arts you don't know about, okay? It's art that hasn't been appropriated yet. So, so you wanna make sure that you're not doing that. And that just takes humility, right? Just a practice of humility. What do I know and what don't I know? And again, the value of money. What am I willing to use our dollars for to get the education and the knowledge that I don't know? Okay? Savior complex, yes. Nobody needs me to unpack that. Being reactive instead of proactive, okay? Yeah. What you got, Mr. Ali? Oh, it's another question. How do talkbacks serve colonialist ideals, right? So again, let me be clear, when I'm talking about colonialist ideals, we're talking about those who colonized the United States, right? Which would be who? Whites. They weren't whites then. Right? Okay? So the British came over here and they brought all their ideals with them, right? So how do talkbacks serve that? Now when I say ideals, I talk about how do you take in information? Right? What's the standard of taking in information? How do you share information? I'm going to generalize, so please allow it. Generally, communities of color, when in a mixed company, or it's majority white people, one or two persons of color, are not going to unpack whatever it is they watched when they feel like it's the potential for them to be attacked, or when they feel like they're going to have to represent the whole of whatever category they're in. Okay? 5 minutes. Ooh. Thank you, Lord. So, thinking about the talkback. Mr. Ali, I love what you said about taking performance to the people, right? Rethinking about talkbacks. Do they have to happen after a show? You know? Do they have to happen in that setting? Are you creating affinity groups? Are you creating different ways for people to unpack what they saw? And again, if what they saw was trauma laden, how at the end of that talkback are you putting people back together before you kick them the hell out of your theater, but not before asking for more of their money? Yes? So that becomes important. And again, this isn't necessarily like Kumbaya, okay? Which I recently just found was a song from the Bella. Ah, love it. Okay, but...
What
was that? Sorry. Okay, I'll tell you later. But again, it could be burning incense. It could be having offerings. It could be bringing in pictures of people who may have gone through this thing. It's just, I'm not an expert in self-care, right? But I do know that different cultures value different ways of caring for one another. And that we need to begin to think in a more broader sense about a talkback and what purpose it is. I also am really choking down telling you all to stop having talkbacks about racial things, and nobody on the panel is in any of those categories, right? That's not okay. I don't care if they're an expert. It's not okay. It's optics. It's optics. There's no way you could tell me in this country you could not find someone to have that dialogue who actually identifies in whatever category that was, okay? All right, can I just take maybe one more and then we'll move on? Do I have like 2 minutes left?
Yes.
Don't worry, I'm on your time. Is that one? Can you get on?
Well, I just respect you, so I
don't know. Okay, let's do this one. Here you go. Thank you. So here, this can relate more to you all, and this can be like our final thought. So what is educational programming role in social justice and movements against racism, imperialism, and white supremacy? You may say my theater is not into social justice whatsoever, and I'm gonna call bullshit on that, okay? Theater is a revolutionary act every single time, even if you're putting up dead artists that don't nobody really wanna see anymore, it's still a revolutionary act. So, social justice is absolutely something that you are engaging in, because you don't have the power to control the person who sits in the audience, walks out of there changed. I'm in theater today because of Phantom of the Opera. I bet if you had to pull yourself, you wouldn't have guessed it, yeah? Okay? So, you need to be saying, what's my role in that? How am I protecting or advocating for the communities that I'm asking to come into my space? Yeah? That's important. And that means you're gonna have to do, Raymond, I'm coming back to you, sometimes you're gonna have to do uncomfortable things like challenge people who don't know what the fuck they're talking about. Sorry, young people, about touch and the power to create in relationships that are strong, right? Sometimes we have to stand up to the, or get, or move along. I don't know y'all financial situation, so don't nobody quit and then start emailing jobs or anything like that, right? That's part of it too. Coming back, like clapping back to these organizations that don't understand the community that you're saying you lose money for, okay? So movements against racism, imperialism, and white supremacy. It's not enough to say Black Lives Matter, and I have seen these signs in so many theatrical situations and institutions, and yet, when I look at the payroll, I don't see Black Lives Mattering and money coming from that institution, right? So, if you are onto a movement in some way, shape, or form, it isn't about taking white people and moving them off the chess, okay? We're not trying to dump them in a ditch somewhere and replace them with people of color. It is a really, literally, about making space. And as this young lady in the back was talking about, the more space we make, the better we are, right? So we want to be thinking about those things too. I think I'm probably at my 2 minutes. Don't want to encroach on anybody's lunch time. Hey, Greg, can we just use last two slides so I don't... Somebody says I plagiarized their work. Oh, I forgot. Talkbacks, I said, were about mending relationships to me. Because our relationships in the theater are broken with our communities. Many of them are. So the questions that you had, they were adapted from the conference proposal. It was titled Race and Poetics and Poetry in the UK, Legacies of Colonialism, and that's the website if any of you are interested for more information. Next one. And this is how we stay connected, right? Yes, I'm in DC, but I'm not afraid to travel. So, NicoleMoniBoer@gmail.com. My website, NicoleMBoer.com. I gotta be honest, I'm not really a tech person. I don't have Instagram. I rarely check my Facebook. And I don't really update my website. Can I just be that honest? I feel like we can. So if you need me, my point is email me. In the Gmail, you will get a response. I want to thank you all for your time, your talent, and your artistry. Having a great lunch or wherever we're going. Oh, we're not lunch, we're not going next. Okay. Oh, I have to take questions.
Get out strong.
Yeah, questions?
Oh, is she saying, could everyone speak up with their questions for the hour? Do you have any questions?
So I think that I like the Black Lives Matter, but we don't see them in the leadership structures. And the pushback is, well, we can't find black people or people of color who have the expertise or who can do the work of leadership. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting because Black Lives Matter, but they can't lead. And I just want to throw that out. And you can engage it or not.
Yeah. Yes, sir?
I want to say this. I think I appreciate you bringing everything that you've said to the fore, chiefly because what it makes our whole beautiful field have to do is reevaluate how we do everything.
Yeah.
Right? And that's hard when we're talking about culture, tradition, storytelling in a particular way, especially when it connects to culture and people. To integrate that construct and make it broader and to be aware about what that then means makes folk have to open their lens, to your point. The aperture becomes even more open. And I want to say to all of my colleagues, because you could feel the because I do the same thing you do in that group agreement, I can feel when that space gets, touched upon. And I do want to say, colleagues, lean into it. Because Shakespeare is one great world writer, right? But there are tons of storytelling traditions that predate that great writer. So why not bring it all in? So thank you.
Community engagement, it's over there, and internal advocacy.
here. We haven't gotten to some of those sessions yet, but I wanted, if you have things that are percolating and you haven't had a chance yet, that will be your opportunity. For now, we're gonna have a 15-minute break. We're getting started on our break a little bit later, 15 minutes and about 20 minutes of 12. We're gonna gather back here. We have so much to fit in today. So please take care of yourselves. There are restrooms, there's more coffee, and we'll see you back shortly.
It does muscular.
Really.
All right.